Hi, I'm Terri Meyer. Welcome to my easel. I'm going to be giving you a watercolor demonstration as a free introductory offer to understand my painting techniques. And so I invite you to join me at my easel as we paint this together.
We're going to be painting a barn scene in watercolors. We're using Prang watercolor set, 140-pound watercolor paper, 5 by 7 inches. First thing that you'll need is the watercolor set. Just spray it with some water. It has red, orange, yellow, green, blue, purple, brown, and black as the colors that we'll be using to get today with a brush. We start with a line drawing, and I just use graphite paper. And the first thing that I do is I wet down the watercolor paper. So I'm going to do an underpainting, where I just add light washes of color. Now I don't want it sopping wet, just wet enough that the paint that I apply is going to spread easily onto the paper. Now I'm adding yellow to the side that's being hit by sunlight on that left side of the barn. So I'm just using yellow straight off the palette, adding a little red, mixing it with just a little bit of yellow, and just haphazardly laying it in. I'm not being very cautious about anything at this point, and you notice that the paint is very light and fluid. And that's what I want. This is what's going to give it a nice visual interest in the end. So now I'm wetting down the sky, and I'm going to be laying in the blue. So I'm just taking, before I do that, I'm adding a little bit of red to the roof line here. Drips and all of that right at this point will not matter. Now I'm taking the blue and starting at the top, just letting it run down. Now you can tell it's not too wet, it's just damp. If it was really wet, it would just run straight off the canvas. So I just want it damp. And just taking care to go around the barn, because I don't want all that blue on the barn. I want to keep that clean at this point. And I am adding a little red into the sky. It kind of gives a hint of clouds, color variation. And also behind the barn there's a tree line, so that's going to be a little bit darker. So I'm just letting that all blend together. Just adding a little texture in there with the brush, making it look like there's some light clouds in the sky. And I cleaned my brush with a paper towel, and now I'm just reestablishing that roof line on the barn by lifting off a little bit of paint. Now I'm adding the tree line behind the barn, using blue, red, and yellow, making a gray kind of purple tone. And you can see it's running into the roof line ever so slightly. But at this point, again, it's still just the underpainting, and it's no big deal. Adding a little bit more red on the top of the barn because the trees are peeking above the barn. Taking the paper towel and just ever so gently lifting a little bit of the paint off. Now, this is wet and it will dry a lot lighter than what you see here. That's the thing about watercolor. When you first put it down, you think, oh my gosh, it's very dark, but by the time that it dries, it'll be much lighter. Now I'm adding some blue, just deepening that value right over the top of what I'd already put in there. And it looks awfully bright at this point, but again, it will dry much lighter. And it is blending with the colors that are already established on the paper. Taking a brush and just reestablishing the back of the roof line of the barn. Just run it across and lift it off. Same thing at the top. Getting a couple runs, just lifting it off. So the paper is still very damp at this time. So you can, one of two things, sit and wait for it to dry before you add your next level of paint, or you can take a hair dryer and dry it so that way you can get to the next phase of the painting. So the underpainting is now complete and I'm just letting it dry. And now I'm adding red. And it's got quite a bit of water in the paint because the color is fairly light. It's not a real dark red. If I used less water, the color would be a lot more vibrant. But again, I'm still in the underpainting. I'm just establishing layers of paint. And I'll go back over this with a deeper tone as we get further into the painting. So I'm painting around the overhang and around the barn doors. And I'm adding a purple color along the back of the barn on the left-hand side. And I'm adding it's a deep red purple along the bottom of the roof line, the top roof line, because that is in shadow and it's much deeper and richer in color. Now I'm adding a medium color gray to the roof line where I'm taking basically the three colors I've been using, red, yellow, and blue, to make a medium charcoal color. The top roof line is slightly darker than the bottom roof line. Now you can really see the blue coming out on that stroke. And I let a lot of the colors mix right on the paper versus mixing it on the palette. It just makes it visually more interesting in the painting than just having a solid color that you've mixed on the palette. And just taking my brush, establishing the bottom of that roof line and the back of the roof line. You notice that the brush has a nice little point to it, so that way you can get those little details. Now I'm going to add a little bit of water to that blue paint that I'm using, and I'm going to do the bottom roof line, and it's slightly lighter, not changing the colors that I'm using, just adding water to it. And I'm not too concerned with little drips here and there. That, again, makes it your painting very interesting. It doesn't all have to be pristine. The less pristine, actually, the better. Sloppy is good when you work with watercolors, especially at this stage where it's all underpainting. Now I'm establishing the roof line, shadow on the front of the barn, and I'm adding the barn doors, which is, I could have used black, but I thought black was too harsh, so I just used blue with a little red in it. It's less harsh, and it's just visually more appealing to the eye. But you definitely have to go darker in value to make it read correctly, that there is an opening in the door. And then establishing the shadow, cast shadow underneath the overhang door or overhang roof line. And there's also a little, there's another door there underneath that overhang. And there's a door that comes out the side of the barn. And just kind of let the paints flow together. If you notice a lot, I'll just dab it and let it flow together. And again, reestablishing the darkness of that cast shadow. And look how it creates the dimension on the barn. Now I'm creating a cast shadow right up underneath the upper roof line. And I'm softening that line so it's not so harsh, just with a damp brush. And I just stand back and look at it for a few minutes and decide what direction I'm going to go next. Just waiting for the paper to dry a little bit. So I'm starting to add some detail to certain areas, and I don't want it all running together. Sometimes if you're in a hurry, you can use a hairdryer and just dry the paper. Now I'm adding a deeper color red. Got more paint, so it's more vibrant than the first layer that I put down. The first layer of red also had just a slight bit of yellow in it. And I very rarely use a watercolor set like we're using today as this demonstration, and I must say that I was very impressed with the vibrancy of color on this watercolor set, because I painted this painting with my artist's professional quality when I did a plein air of it, which is on location painting first, and the colors are almost as vibrant as using my professional set. So I would highly recommend this as a great starting kit for you. It's approximately $5 for it, so you don't have to put out a lot of money, and you can try your hand at it to see if you like it without, you know, a big investment. If you notice, I'm just kind of, again, laying in, not trying to make everything uniform. I like little slices of the underpainting showing through. It creates a textural effect, which is pleasing to the eye. And I'm leaving a little bit of the roof line, a little highlight there to show the sun is hitting that, along with the overhang. That's why the underpainting was important. It's not pure white, but it's got a little bit of yellow in it. So just giving it a few minutes to let it dry, and then moving on to the next color. Now the right side of the barn is in shadow, so I'm going to be putting a purple color on that lower edge of the building. It's almost the same color as the roof line, but just a little more gray. So I've added a little yellow to that. That will gray it down. And that actually is not, that part of the barn is not red. It's white. It's a canvas that you can open the barn up, so then you get a nice breeze going through the barn in the summertime for the cows. So if you're wondering why it's not painted a red color, it's because it's actually a white canvas on that side of the barn. Although at the back end, that is red siding, where the door is on the right-hand side. Now there's a cast shadow on the lower roof line that's being cast by the upper roof line. And it's reflecting a lot of blue from the sky, so I'm just establishing that now. You can notice that that is a lot deeper in value. Basically, I'm just using the blue with just a tad bit of water. Just reestablishing that little barn door opening. Reestablishing the cast shadow underneath the overhang. And that's one thing with watercolor, it's a dance. You go back and forth. Is it light enough? Is it dark enough? Do I need to add more color? Do I need to soften an edge? You're constantly looking and questioning those things. Now I'm getting ready to put in the ground, and I'm just putting in green. And I'm going to add some brown because there's a lot of mud in front of the barn. It's winter time, and so we get snow and rain, and everything gets muddy when the cows are out tracking through the pasture. So I just let the brown run right into the green, and I added a little bit more water, lightened it a little bit in front of the actual front of the barn, added just a hint of green. And see how visually interesting that is by not having it all one solid color of green. And there are some trees next to the barn, so I'm just putting in a little bit of a charcoal purple color. And making that overhang roof line pop out, because I'm painting around it. It's starting to come together now. This is the exciting part. It's got a lot of life to it, just because of the underpainting and leaving little splotches of color here and there. Not everything is just straight edges and perfect. There's a lot of non-perfect parts to this painting, which makes it visually more interesting. So now I'm getting ready to put in the fence with the grass that is along the fence line. So I'm just letting it dry for a few moments. Actually, I realized, okay, I need to put in the cast shadow underneath the lower roof line. So I'm just adding a deep purple color to establish that and see how that makes that look more three-dimensional just with that cast shadow. And now I'm deciding I'm going to put in some of the trees. It is winter time, they have no leaves on them. So I'm just doing upward strokes lightly with the tip of the brush. Just kind of squiggly lines, actually. A very light touch. I don't want it to be really bold sticks. I want it to be very light, loose sticks. Making the impression of a tree. And you notice that I'm taking it out at angles like a tree would be. Keeping most of the twigginess within the boundaries of my established background. And now I'm putting in the grassy area underneath the fence post. And again, just squiggly lines to give the impression of a grassy area beneath the fence post. And I'm just using a little bit of brown and a little bit of green together to make it very earthy in tone. And even the fence posts, I'm not worrying about them being totally straight. Actually, the more variation, kind of off to the side and not perfect, make it look more realistic on a barn scene. And this is completed, and I hope you've enjoyed the video, and I would love to see your rendition of this painting, so please do share it with me, and thank you for joining me at the easel. It's been a pleasure. Oh, and just one last thing. I've decided there's a cast shadow from the barn is a reflection, not a cast shadow, but a reflection of the red from the barn on the ground. So I'm laying that in. And now it's complete.